Today I'm going to go over a full tutorial on trial director for iPad. So trial director for iPad is an app that some of the students in the Chicago Kent College of Law litigation technology class used for the midterm. Others used trial pad for the midterm. So to kind of make sure everyone's on the same page as we go forward towards the final, I wanted to make sure we did a full tutorial on trial director for iPad. And in either event, for both classes, I think that you guys are going to need a little bit more instruction on how to get all the exhibits into the app so that you can use them. So I wanted to go over that specifically as well. Now, Trial Director for iPad is an app that lets you pull up the exhibits that you want in a nonlinear fashion. So you can go to any exhibit on demand, connecting an iPad to an external monitor or a jury screen or a courtroom AV system, however your setup is. And so today what we're gonna do is we're gonna dive right into the app. Let me get my screen recording started on my app, and then we'll take a look at the Trial Director for iPad app itself. So here we are, my actual iPad, and we're gonna take a look at the app. The first time you get in there, you're gonna be put into kind of the main menu area. And I'm gonna assume that everyone kind of already knows what these kind of apps do. Typically when I teach software like this, I like to kind of do the end result first. So I give you kind of the wow, or like what's the whole point of this all first, and then I go to how you go back and build it. I typically don't like to start out any type of software tutorial with like, and here's how you build the case file. I feel like I need to get some more buy-in first. I want to give you guys excited about the app first, but I think you guys all kind of know where we're going with it. So we're going to skip right ahead to building the case file. So in the bottom of the app, there is an area with a plus sign in the lower left-hand corner. I'm going to touch that, and then I'm going to connect my Dropbox account. Now my Dropbox account has already been connected to this particular iPad, and when I'm connected to the internet, it'll pull up my actual Dropbox account and the folders inside there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to then go to the area where my case files are. So for you guys in your finals specifically, we're no longer using Dropbox to distribute the class materials, at least not the class Dropbox that we've been using throughout the semester. Instead, what I sent all of you guys your case materials with a download link. The idea being now you guys are on your own trial teams and you want to prepare separately and apart from your opponents. And so each of you guys are responsible for maintaining your own Dropbox accounts to the extent that you want to do that. So that's something that you share with just your trial partner and not everyone else in the class. So what you'll do is you'll take those, and let's use the Grabowski case file, for example, but if you have the Howell case file for your final, we can use that too. And the exhibits that you're going to want to put in Dropbox are the exhibits folder. Once they're up there, then you should be able to see them like in the app, like I have it now. And I'm gonna hit the download button, and I haven't created this case file yet. So I'm gonna hit select all, so I download all the PDFs that are in this folder, and I'm gonna hit download files. It asks me, do I wanna create a project or download to an existing project? That means, do I need to create a new case, or do I wanna download these to an existing case? Why they call them projects? I'm not sure. And we'll just call it Grabowski. And for you, it doesn't matter. Like, you might think I should put it like defendant or prosecution, but it's your iPad only. You're not sharing this with the other side. You could just call it the case name. So we'll call it that, and we'll start downloading. And so we can see that it's starting to download. It goes through all of them. It's going to depend on how big the files are and how quick your Wi-Fi connection is to get all these files downloaded. All right, now it's giving us a little pop-up letting us know it's all done. Then we'll hit done again. And now we have a folder in Trial Director for iPad that says Grabowski. And from there, we're gonna take a look at this. And what I always like to do for all of these is make sure that everything made it into the app okay. And so I'll go through and I'll like click on each exhibit that's in there to make sure I actually have an exhibit. Sometimes, and I've seen this previously in earlier versions of TrialPad and sometimes in Trial Director for iPad, where it'll look like on the left-hand side that the exhibit looks just fine, but then when I go to touch it and see it, it's either in backwards for some reason or it's just not even there. So I always like to go through and check on that. The other thing that you'll notice is that this is in like alphanumeric order, but like not that smart alphanumeric order. So it's going 1, 10, 11, 12, and then it goes to 18, 19 to 20. So one of the things that you might want to do is go through and rename some of those PDFs and re-import them. Something to keep in mind. Some apps are smart and can understand the difference between 1 and 10 in terms of how many digits there are. Some apps can't, and that's just the case with this one, at least for the way that these were downloaded. So I'm going to assume that I've got all these in here. I recommend that you go through them all and check all them yourself, but now I have everything in there. So now I'm looking at the app. I've got all these exhibits in here. It should look familiar. If you learned on Trial Pad for the midterm, this should look really familiar. And hopefully this is a review for all of you who use Trial Direct for iPad for the midterm. But we'll go through and let's just grab, let's see, this expert report. I'll take a look at it. If I want to flip through the pages, I'm just going to swipe to get through the different pages in this particular document. And then I'll look at some of these annotation tools that I have. First, the first, I guess, annotation tool that I have is like pinch and zoom. It's not really an annotation tool, but it zooms in, makes it so that way I can see what I'm working with a little bit better. If I wanted to do a call out, like the call outs that we've been making in the PowerPoints, I can certainly do that. The tool all at the end is a call out tool. And then I'm going to drag a rectangle from like the upper, I guess, left hand corner and drag it all the way down to the lower right hand corner of the area I want to highlight. And then I'll do that. And then that's the call out that's going to appear. And then I can kind of move it around and play with it a little bit. It's not quite as fully featured as the call outs in Trial Pad if you're used to that, but at least you're getting a call out. From there, once you have the call out, you can annotate things. You can also do these annotations even without the call out. Let's say, for example, you want to put that away. You could just hit the X in the upper left hand corner and then it'll go away. So let's bring a call out back and we'll go to this paragraph here and let's move it to an area that I'd like to see it. And then from here, I'm going to use the highlight tool first. So let's say I want to focus on the second sentence. So like as I'm talking with the witness, I might ask the witness, can you read the second sentence for me of this paragraph? They might start reading. And it's again, same thing. Touch and hold the upper left-hand corner and drag down to the lower right-hand corner. I like to highlight like one line at a time as someone's reading it because it helps the jurors to kind of like follow along. So we'll do that and I'll do the highlight there. And you could see it shows up on the call out and also the underlying document right behind it. So I think that's really cool. I'm still on the highlight tool so I can then have more highlighting as the witness is reading the sentence and as they're finishing on it, then I can say between them. And now I've got a really nice highlight, very bright yellows, crisp, dark text, and the highlight looks really, really nice. So I like that. The next thing I can do, let's close that call out just for a moment. But notice I only closed the highlight, the call out, the highlight still remained behind there. And so the next tool is a drawing tool. So not all that sophisticated. It's kind of hard actually to write. Even if you have something like the Apple Pencil, it's just not that great for writing. I'm not a huge fan of it. The one area that I will use it is, let's say I have a map of some sort and I'm looking at it and I want to circle something. Let's use the tool. Then I can circle something that's really nice. Or if I have a photograph, like this photograph, for example, then I could say like, you know, tell me where you were standing when you heard the gunshots or something along those lines, whatever the question may be. I'll use that drawing tool, the freeform drawing tool, and I can say, that's me, that's where I was standing. So that's kind of the way that I like to use that tool, if at all. I very rarely use it. You also have a straight line tool as well. So let's say I want to look at this JetBlue confirmation and I want to underline something or I want to point to something. That's something that I can do very easily. Like if I want to draw like an arrow, that's something that I can do. If I need to change the color of any of these things, like I have the circle here and I want to talk about the departure time, right? Let's say I want to circle something else and I circle it in a different color. I'm going to long press on the tool that I'm using, and then I can use this kind of color picker to pick a different color that I'm going to use. And there. So now I got this color. And now the next circle that I make is that other color. So that's one of the ways that you can change colors. Same thing with the rectangle tool. And let's go to this. And let's say that we want to focus everyone's attention on the basic information that was filled out on this form. We could do that and then zoom in. You have a nice little rectangle box that you can use there. And then the last tool that the last two tools that we'll talk about is the laser tool. For example, if you're presenting in a room that doesn't have a projection screen, so if everything's an LCD monitor, then a laser pointer isn't going to work because LCD monitors are designed to reject ambient light. So if you got light coming in from a window or from overhead lights, The TVs try not to show that because it interferes with your viewing of the image, but that also means that laser pointers don't work. So in that situation, let's get the laser pointer tool out and I can kind of point. It sets the laser point, like if I'm pointing like right here, the laser will actually be like right here. So you can see underneath your finger when you're pointing, but that's a good way to like get everyone's attention. Tell me like, what did he write for the address? What did he write for the city? Did he abbreviate it? Did he write Chicago all the way out? So that's one of the things that you can do if you wanna make sure you're further directing jurors' attentions. But my favorite way to do that kind of thing is to just say, now let's look at the city field. And I like highlight it really quick. And then there's another tool in the lower right-hand corner that looks like an arrow pointing backwards, and that's the undo. Right, so you click that, it goes undo once, undo twice, it remembers a couple of steps backwards, so that makes it really nice. Now the last thing is a redaction tool. Now this works exactly like the highlight tool or the rectangle tool, where you hold down in the upper left-hand corner and then drag until you've finished highlighting or redacting in this case, what you wanna redact, and then let go, and then you'll have a redaction box. So let's say there's personally identifying information on here that I was supposed to remove, but I forgot, and I want to be able to still publish this exhibit. Before I publish it, I can say, all right, well, maybe the street address needs to be obscured. So I'll do that. And now I've obscured it. Now no one can see it. And now I can publish it up. Now, some of the other tools, just to round out some of the other tools that are out here, there is a side-by-side tool. So for example, like in this case, the Grabowski case, handwriting analysis is a really important part of it. And so we could take a look at this handwriting sample and look at that. Maybe we want to zoom in on a specific area on the left-hand side. Then we'll touch the right-hand side to put in something else there. And from there, let's find, let's see, I think there's an exhibit for checks. Let's look at one of these checks and see how this person wrote their numbers when they wrote checks. And now I can have two things side-by-side so I can compare them. And I'll push that up to the screen so the jurors can see both exhibits at the same time. So that's one of the things I can do. Then if I hit that same button again in the lower right-hand corner, it toggles back to one exhibit at a time versus two, and it'll toggle you back to whichever exhibit is selected. So if I touch the one on the left, I have that like red rectangle around it. That tells me if I do anything, it'll be done to this side. If I switch back to single exhibit view, it'll be for that exhibit. Or if I want to look at the checks, I'll touch the right-hand side, then toggle it back to a single page view, and so I have that. So that's how you go back and forth there. The next button, this one's pretty useless in my mind. It's just a whiteboard. So if you did want to write a whole bunch of stuff, like answer some questions for the jury, like if you want to write things to consider, you know, my handwriting is not so great in pen, and on an iPad it's miserable. So you can write, like make a whiteboard if for some reason you wanted to do that. I don't really recommend it, but that's what that tool does. So if you hit the X in the right-hand corner, it clears everything that's all on the screen. So that's basic navigation, and it's basically how you get through all of the tools that are in there as well. And so on the lower left-hand side, though, there's some other kind of sub-functions that I think we should look at. Right now, we're looking at all the exhibits. So everything we have in this case, and right now, all we have is PDFs, so documents and photographs. But if we want to look at just the documents, or just the PDFs and the JPEGs that are in here, that would be that. Then we could filter it by that icon that looks like a page, like a dog-eared page. That's the one that we have. If we want to look at just the multimedia that we have in here, and I didn't import any media yet, although the process would be the same for importing the documents that we did, I would click on that and any media that I'd have would be in there. Now the last one here is blank as well, and that's bookmarks. So let's go back to looking at all the documents first. And let's say I'm starting to get ready for a direct examination and I want to not have to worry about finding everything in here. Like for example, I had to hunt and peck and look for the checks before I could show them to you when I did the exhibit side by side. Let's say I don't really want to have to worry about that when it comes time to actually do the direct examination of that handwriting expert. So let's take the handwriting expert's report, expert report, exhibit 11. And then in the upper left-hand corner of the viewing area or where the tools are, there is a little button that looks like a bookmark with a plus sign. Touch it once, and now that exhibit is in my bookmarks area, so I have it there. Then if I go back into that same area and then go to checks, now I have the checks, and I can bookmark that, and I have it again in that bookmarks area. So now I have a separate area where I can make a more condensed list of just the exhibits that I'm gonna want as I'm preparing for the next examination, so it makes things a little bit easier for me there. So now I have both of the things right there, right next to each other. Oh, maybe in addition to the expert report, I also want that handwriting sample, so let's get that. That is exhibit 13, and we'll bookmark that. So now I have three things. I have the expert report, and I have the handwriting sample. Let's say I'd want to do that side by side. On the left-hand side, I've got the handwriting sample. On the right-hand side, I've got the checks. I could do that. Let's see what other handwriting samples might I need. There are the captions underneath the photo, so let's get that photos with captions exhibit. So I want that one, and we'll add it to my bookmarks as well. So now I've got all those. So I can go through, and for this witness, I can talk about the handwriting sample, talk about the checks, and then if I want to, I can also go to the photos and the captions from the back that are kind of like put onto the same exhibit here. So that makes it nice and easy. So I have all like the same type of exhibit or all the exhibits from the same witness in the same area. So I don't have to do any hunting and pecking, especially like in the middle of exam where I might get nervous. So those are the basics for navigating and getting around an exhibit in Trial Director for iPad. Now let me download a video file for you guys just so you can see how that works. And so we can play around with a little bit in terms of what that's gonna look like when you're actually trying to use it in court. So I'm gonna hit the home button to go back to my main screen, and in the lower left-hand corner, I'm gonna hit the plus sign. This should be a little bit of a review. Going back to the Dropbox area, and then I'm gonna get to my actual Dropbox folder, and then I'm gonna go to where my case files are, and let's go to the Grabelsky case file, and we'll go to the depositions section, because I know that there is a very short video file in there, or it's an audio file, and I'm gonna get that. It's a WAV file. I'm gonna download just that, and download it to an existing project, download to project, Grabelsky. Download it there. It's gonna start downloading, and it's a really short audio file, so it shouldn't take that long. It's finished, done. Now I'm gonna go back into my case file, and I'll see if I go into the media section that it's in there. If I click on it, then I'll get regular play controls like I might normally see if I'm watching a video like on an iPhone or an iPad or any other smart device. I can hit play to start listening to it, and I could scrub through it. There's no visuals to really show along with it because it's just an audio file, but it's here. So I can scrub through it, fast forward through it to any point that I need, if I need to do that for fast forwarding purposes, because maybe it's a longer video, maybe it's 30 minutes long, and I only need a very specific section, so I can do that as well. I'll hit pause to pause it, and that's how you interact with exhibits that are multimedia, like video or audio. I can even put this into my bookmark section. So I hit the bookmark icon, and now it's in that same list as well with all the other exhibits. And even in my bigger case at large, let's see, where is it? No, exhibit number 3, the 911 call, is still in my regular list, the somewhat alphanumeric list of exhibits that I have. So that's multimedia. Now the last thing that I'll go over is the thing that I normally go over first when I normally talk about apps like Trial Director for iPad or TrialPad or any other trial presentation software. It's how do you publish it? So let's do that. I'm gonna get an external monitor out so you can see what kind of like what it looks like when I'm going to be publishing these kinds of things. So now the only difference now, and I'll take some screenshots here, between what you were looking at before and now that I'm connected to another screen, is that there should be new buttons in the upper right-hand corner of the app. And there's 4 buttons. And on the screen that I'm connected to, my jury monitor or whatever projector that I'm connected to, we should be able to see if the systems are all communicating correctly, the Trial Director for iPad logo. This one is giant. I don't think it should be that big. It's pretty obnoxious. I've talked to them about it. They think that it needs to be there. And after all, it's a free app. So I'm gonna give them a hard time about it because I don't think that's appropriate to have as a background, as a default background for an app. But you know what? The price, you get what you pay for. So that's why at least you know it's working and you're ready to show exhibits. Now, the most tempting thing to do right now is to hit that TV button that has a play like little triangle on it, because it looks like that's how I would publish this exhibit that I'm looking at right now. But you never actually want to touch that play button, because what that does is it turns on mirror mode. So right now we're using it in kind of the extended desktop or the dual screen mode that we like for all our trial presentation software. I can see on my iPad exactly what I want to see, like my control panel, and the jurors, they see something else. If I hit that play button, what that does is it doesn't publish an exhibit. Instead, what it does is it puts on that other screen exactly what's on my screen right now. This function is really only for when you're preparing in the war room for a trial and you're working maybe with the witness, or you're showing the other attorneys on your team, hey, this is how the app is set up. Or if I were doing a training in person, this is how I'd be showing you guys in class how I'm using this app by hitting that play button. So let's turn that button back off and get back to kind of our regular display mode. If I want to actually publish this exhibit that I have, I'm going to hit the show button. Then I see on my jury screen the exhibit that I want to look at and only the exhibit that I want to look at. The jurors aren't seeing like the names of my exhibits on the left-hand side. They aren't seeing any of my tools. They aren't seeing my bookmarks, anything like that. They're just seeing the exhibit. If I pinch to zoom in, then the app also zooms in on just that screen as well. Something to keep in mind, I zoomed in pretty much as far as I could go on this particular exhibit. And if I look at my screen, a 16:9 like wide screen, it's still not taking up the full screen. There's black pillars on each side. And that's because this particular app only outputs to a 4:3 aspect ratio screen, or like the older kind of like tube monitor dimensions. It can't take advantage of the full width of your screen if you're connected to a widescreen. It's just another unfortunate limitation of this app. But everything that I'm doing now in the app is happening in real time on the other side so the jurors can look at it too. So if I wanted to do a call out of say just this check number 102, I've got this call out here, then I can highlight perhaps some of the numbers that are in there and the jurors are seeing that as well. If I want to clear it, I hit the X button and that goes away as well. And so that's how I would interact with it. When I'm done with the exhibit, I want to take it down. I hit the clear button and then it comes down. I'm still seeing that logo, but at least the exhibit itself is down. I don't have to ask the judge, judge, can you remove the exhibit for me or permission to take it down? I might still ask judge permission to remove the exhibit, but then I can also control it myself, which is vitally important because let's say I want to go then to another exhibit and we'll go to this termination letter. And then I want to put that up. Maybe it's a previously admitted exhibit and the judge has given us permission to publish any previously admitted exhibits. I can just then publish the exhibit. I don't have to wait for the judge to then turn back on my console so that I could publish it to the jury. It saves a lot of time to be able to put up and put down the exhibits in a timely fashion so the judge doesn't start getting nervous. So I'm going to clear that exhibit and it goes away. So what about this pause button that's in the middle here? Let's say we're looking at this termination letter. And we're showing it to the jury. Let's put it back up and show it to the jury. What is that button in the middle pause for? I don't really use the pause button very much just because I think the app is pretty easy to get through quickly. But let's say we're looking at this exhibit, we're having the witness read from it, and I want to hurry up and get, for example, maybe the JetBlue confirmation notice ready. But I don't want to take this exhibit down. I can hit this pause button, and now that exhibit is frozen on the jury monitor. And I can now look through here and find, I don't remember the exhibit number, but let's go find, JetBlue. There it is. Is that the exhibit I want? Yes, that's the exhibit I want. So now I can finish up with this part of the exam and say, now I want to talk to you about exhibit 18, the JetBlue exhibit, which has been previously submitted. I'm going to publish it to you now. So I can jump from like one exhibit to another really quickly using that pause function. Now, I think that from a practical standpoint, let's go to that termination letter again. Where is it? 28. If we're looking at this, I feel like we can look at it, talk about it, do any highlighting that we need to do. Let's say maybe, for example, we want to talk about this first sentence. So we're looking at that. And then we want to go from there quickly to the next exhibit. I just either would have it as a bookmark so I can go to the next exhibit, or I would just not worry, it doesn't take that long to find most of the exhibits, especially not for the case of the sizes that you're dealing with for this class. So I can quickly get to it there. I just don't find the pause button to be all that useful, but that's what it is in case you need it. The more important button is the show button and also the clear button so you can take an exhibit down when you're ready to take it down. So that is a quick crash course on Trial Director for iPad in case you need to do it as kind of the backup homeworks that we've been assigning. I know some of you guys don't have access to a Windows PC, and so you do have access to an iPad. I'd like for you to download all of your exhibits from your final exam into Trial Director for iPad and use that as you prepare for the final and start getting your materials ready. For those of you that you do have Windows PCs, I want you to be using OnQ. And there's directions in the syllabus for those of you who don't have PCs or an iPad. There's another step for you there as well. So check the syllabus to go over what we're doing for you guys there. If you have any other questions about Trial Director for iPad or how it all works or how you can get it to work, or if you're having troubles, for those of you in the class, feel free to email me at any time. For those of you who are watching on YouTube that are not in the class, feel free to leave in the comments down below, and I'd love to talk to you guys about it more down there. That's all I have for today, everybody. Thanks for making it all the way to the end of this video, and I'll see you in the next one. That's right.